Welcome to Workers World Party's latest webinar, The Racist For-Profit Healthcare System Kills, We Need Socialism. I'm Makasi Matema. We're currently live on Facebook, so if you like our video, please share. For those of you watching on Zoom, you can click the Q&A button on the bottom of the screen and type in your questions. Our speakers will start answering questions around 8 p.m. Eastern time. So if you're comfortable, leave your pronouns in your city. Hosting with me is Judy Greenspan from the Barrier chapter of Workers' World Party in California.
Thanks, Makasi. Tonight, we'll be speaking about the racist for-profit healthcare system in the US. The COVID-19 crisis has exposed the cruelty and dysfunction of the capitalist system. Tens of thousands of people are dying, and they are disproportionately Black, Brown, Asian, and Indigenous. Capitalism has failed. Many of us have known that it's been failing for a long time, and we need revolutionary socialism to build a healthcare system that is free for all, that is anti-racist, that supports people with disabilities, that is organized for the needs of working and oppressed people. Our guest tonight will be exploring this issue in depth. Is it my turn?
No, I'm sorry, Judy. Yeah, it is.
Okay, sorry. Okay, so I'm sorry. So I'm a public school teacher in Oakland, California. And what I have found and what many of the teachers have found is that the COVID-19 crisis is being used as an excuse to further the gentrification, to further the privatization, to further, this is the time when the city councils and the Board of Supervisors have been meeting to get more funds for the police at times where people are told to shelter in place. And at the same time, just last weekend, Mayor Libby Schaaf announced a big corridor of Oakland would be closed to car traffic. And she basically closed streets predominantly in the Black, the Latinx, and the Asian communities. She did it without talking to anyone from those communities. In fact, she closed a street, which now makes it impossible to get ambulances into Highland Hospital. So there's just this incredible, not only COVID-19, not only am I teaching in an area that has been so hard hit by racism, by gentrification, by dislocation, but this virus, the capitalist system is using this virus as a weapon against the communities that I work in and that I try to represent. So it is actually a very, very, very serious situation that we're going through right now. And that's.
Thank you, Judy. Okay. Please keep sharing the link to join this webinar, which you can see in the side chat on the side of your screen. You can also share the video from Workers World Party on Facebook or at Workers World on Twitter. We're going to start tonight by hearing remarks from Mumia Abu-Jamal, recorded on April 6th. Mumia is our hero. He's an incredible journalist, organizer, and former leader of the Black Panther Party in Philadelphia, who's written many books while incarcerated. We continue to be inspired by Mumia's words and wisdom. Yesterday, unidentified racist guards at SCI Mahoney leaked a malicious rumor that Mumia was suffering from COVID-19. We would like to assure everyone today that these rumors are totally, totally false. So with that, we'd like to play the clip.
COVID-19, weapon of mass incompetence. As of this writing, 10,000 people have died from the impacts of the coronavirus, also known as COVID-19. 10,000. And unless I miss my guess, it ain't over yet. That's because the coronavirus is not slowing down. If anything, it's picking up speed. Almost everything we've heard about the virus from the media during the first week is false or misleading. I'm not talking about the big idiots crowing about it's a hoax. It's not. Originally, it was a virus attacking old people. We now know better. Young people, including children and even infants, have succumbed to this disease. There was an old woman in Italy who contracted the virus. She was sick and then recovered. She was 102 years old. Viruses are living things, and like all living things, they surprise us. The U.S. government had months to prepare for the coming of the coronavirus. They treated it lightly, and nearly 1,000 deaths a day proved that it is indeed deadly serious. We will see worse. From imprisoned nation, this is Mumia Abu Jamal.
And I just want to add that Mumia wrote this on April 6th, and the deaths, unfortunately, have tripled in the United States since then. And we will hopefully be hearing more from Mumia in the coming weeks. Our next webinar will be next Thursday, April 23rd at 7 p.m. We'll be talking about the May Day general strike and organizing to shut down capitalism and build workers' assemblies. Because I don't know if you've been watching the news, but it looks like Trump is trying to send people back to work on May 1st. So International Workers' Day is timed perfectly. Our special guest will be Chris Smalls, who was one of the organizers, the main organizer of the Amazon warehouse strike in Staten Island, which has inspired us all. And you can find more information about that story and much more at workers.org. Our next guest is Shani Akilah from Black and Brown Workers Cooperative, who will speak on the Black and Brown Workers Cooperative's workplace organizing unapologetic campaigns for people who are HIV positive and on the racism that people of color face in the US healthcare system. Shani.
Thank you so much. Thank you to the comrades for inviting us into this conversation. So I will first start with sort of a background on where the Black and Brown Cooperative was birthed from. We were birthed out of a crisis of consciousness. In 2016, I was a whistleblower at one of the largest HIV/AIDS organizations on the East Coast, Philadelphia Fight. I was witnessing some similar racist and white supremacist policies and practices that I had witnessed at other nonprofits specifically. And so what did I see? Well, something that in the Black and Brown Workers Cooperative we've coined as a plantation politic, that is the frontline workers, many, most of whom are from the community that these ASOs profess to serve. These are the workers that are, you know, doing the most hours, getting paid the least, have the least voice in the institution, right? Are the first to be hired and the first to be fired. Hired because they can be tokenized to really appeal to Black and Brown communities, but fired the minute that worker tries to speak up about the racism that they are witnessing in the space. And so as a manager hired at Fight, I was witnessing a lot of frontline workers come into contact with these systems. And I decided, like, I can't just stand by and witness this. This is my community. There is no paycheck, there are no amount of benefits that will allow me to sleep at night knowing that I am continuing to witness the same colonial practices and practices and policies in these ASOs, these aid service organizations, and other institutions like them. So we began to talk to each other as workers. We started sharing our narratives. We started, I heard a lot of like, yup, me too. Like I was also, micromanaged once I started asking about, anti-oppression training for the organization, or, now I'm being asked to, you know, pick up specific tasks or extra tasks because, you know, I voiced my, what I had experienced as racism at an event that occurred, right? So like talking to each other and saying like, this is an issue and we cannot stand by and just watch this, right? Simultaneously, the work that has been done and has resulted in the huge movement across the country against police brutality, you know, Black Lives Matter. At that time, there was a lot of media coverage around the fact that Black bodies were hitting the ground every 28 hours, right? And so we're seeing a correlation between state-sanctioned violence in the streets, right, done via, you know, at the hands of police, via the state, but also state-sanctioned violence in these aid service organizations who are funded by the genocidal state, right? And so, sure, they're being given grant money to say that they're serving Black and brown communities, yet there's no transformation in our communities around the very diseases that are killing us and the vulnerabilities that we are, like HIV. 1 in 2 Black people will contract HIV in their lifetime. 1 in 4 Latinx people will contract HIV in their lifetime. That is a pandemic, right? And so understanding that as workers, our consciousness was being impacted by what was going outside of the walls of those ASOs, but also what we were experiencing firsthand in our agencies. And at some point it became a crisis of consciousness for us as workers to continue to give our labor to the same organizations that are profiting off of the blood in our communities. And so we began directly targeting these aid service organizations for their anti-Black policies and practices. Philadelphia Fight was the first one. Jane Shaw, who is still currently the executive director there, we called her out publicly about her paternalism and her white savior complexes and how it was controlling the way workers, Black and brown workers, felt they can move within those walls. You know, that we started live streaming all our direct actions so that the community could see that the power really is in the people. And we do not, in fact, we have a duty to not stand by and allow these institutions to think that they hold the power. As workers, we are their power. So we decided to remind them of that. I got fired, of course. They saw me as a threat. Once I got fired, you know, I had full-time hours to organize. So me and my comrades, Abdul Ali Muhammad, who also helped to co-found this organization, and Dominique London, who also... Abdul Ali is also a whistleblower. Dominique had to really resist racist practices in her organization. Between the three of us and then countless other comrades in the community, we have been able to remove racist and anti-Black executive directors from Mazzoni Center. So the Mazzoni campaign, that was us organizing in solidarity with workers to get rid of Nurit Shine and Dr. Nguyen. Right? Dr. Nguyen, who was engaging in quid pro quo policies with clients and patients, you know, you do this sexual act for me, I'll give you medication kind of thing. And so, you know, we took them on head on and we ended up in solidarity with the workers from Mazzoni, removing Nurit Shine as well as Dr. Nguyen. Now, of course we know that it is not enough just to remove problematic actors of the state and of the nonprofit industrial complex. That's not enough, clearly. That for me is the bottom bar, and I think for a lot of my comrades. I think ultimately the goal, especially as Black anarchists, which is how our cooperative identifies, our goal is worker-owned and controlled community-based health organizations, period. You know, nothing for us without us, but nothing for us without us leading that and holding that. And so if we are demanding that if community-based organizations say they are community-based, well then in practice they have to be. And only we as workers and community members can demand that. So I guess I don't know how much time I have. I put my alarm on too, because I didn't want to go over. But essentially I think I'll stop there. But I do want to add one last thing, the COVID-19 pandemic. I'm, you know, to just echo Comrade Mumia's words, right? Like this is an unnatural disaster. This is a product of a white supremacist state who did not put in the proper safety net for all citizens in this country. And so now people are being murdered via the state because we have a regime that does not like and actually believes in getting like rid of whole sets of people, right? They're showing us that. They are trying to, they're killing us, and it's intentional. This is not an accident. So I feel like, you know, there's a huge revolution stirring, and I feel like we are in that moment now where we are getting in position. And I look forward to the battle, because when I'm on calls like this with other comrades and I'm in community with other warriors, I know that if we fight, we will win.
Thank you so much, Shani. We really appreciate your remarks. And in the chat, we have put information about how you can reach out to the organization that Shani represents and get involved. And we also put information about a press conference around Mumia, a very important press conference around Mumia Abu-Jamal. So please check out the information on the chat so you can continue to be involved. And if you want to find out more information about the workers' struggle, please go to workers.org. You can sign up for daily updates sent right to your inbox. And if you like what you're seeing, we would love a donation at workers.org/donate or Venmo at Workers World. Now I'd like to introduce Annika Ilyana, a healthcare worker and a caravan organizer for prisoners' rights from Portland, Oregon. Annika.
Hello, good evening, comrades. My name is Annika Ilyana. I am a member of the World Workers Party Portland branch. I'm also a healthcare worker. I work in a clinic outside of Portland. So today I just wanted to talk about what it's been like as a medical provider in this COVID-19 crisis, especially being that the place that I work at is not a part of a large healthcare organization. We serve a more rural, smaller community, more low-income community. And then I also wanted to talk about the car caravan that our branch organized in support of protesting prisoners last week. So I'll just start with what it's been like to be a medical provider during the COVID-19 crisis. It has been unbelievably confusing. There is no set of guidelines that is consistent across, you know, different organizations here in the United States. The CDC has not been a good resource for us. The guidelines that they've published have changed almost on a daily basis. They've also been incorrect since day one. They're still incorrect now. They just recently admitted that masks may be helpful in protecting against transmission and contraction of the virus. And this is something we've already known from China for months and months and months. The reason that they are being inconsistent and the reason that they are not being forthcoming with the role of PPE is because they know that there is a shortage. They know they can't provide healthcare workers with the PPE that we need to protect ourselves, our families, and our patients. And that's why they're giving us inconsistent guidelines. This has resulted in different practices, provider by provider. So within a medical institution, within a clinic, within a healthcare organization, there's no consistency in care. Some clinics are shut down. Some clinics, like mine, are still seeing patients via telemedicine. Another barrier that we've run into is the insurance companies will not provide adequate compensation for these visits, which means that a smaller clinic like mine and other smaller clinics that operate in low-income communities, rural communities, are not able to pay the rent for their building, are not able to pay the staff adequately because these insurance companies are not paying an adequate amount for telemedicine visits because, according to them, they're not real visits. Even though this is a measure that we've taken to keep our patients safe, to keep ourselves and our staff safe, but still, manage people's medical care. So that is another barrier here. And I did just want to talk about, the incarcerated community nationally. From a medical standpoint, this is the treatment is beyond barbaric. To purposefully keep people in an institution where they are overcrowded, where they are not provided with PPE, personal protective equipment, they're not provided with testing, they're not provided with medical care, is a death sentence. It is it is a situation in which the virus has the highest risk of being contracted, it has the highest risk of being transmitted, and it has the highest risk of complication, including mortality. By these governors not releasing prisoners, they are sentencing them to death. There was a protest at the Columbia River Correctional Institute in North Portland last Wednesday, that was April 8th. And you can read more about that in the article, but basically these prisoners protested, and rightfully so, because they were not getting adequate treatment, information, or protection against the virus. So our branch organized a car caravan where we went, and we honked our horns, we made a bunch of noise, and we stood in solidarity with those prisoners because they are receiving a death sentence. We did just recently find out that despite these demands from the public and the prisoners, Kate Brown, our governor in Oregon, has decided that she will not allow the release of any prisoners. So that's where we're at right now. Thank you so much, comrades, for inviting me to speak. Oh, and I also just wanted to throw out, our branch did start a Facebook group. It's called Free Them All PDX. I will put it in the chat. And this is an online platform to organize with local community members and anyone who is passionate about justice for our incarcerated comrades.
Thanks, Annika. Now we'll be speaking with William Camacaro from the Alberto Rivera Solidarity Committee about COVID-19 in Venezuela and the measures they're taking to deal with the virus.
Thank you very much for having me. I'm right now in Valencia, in Venezuela, and I'm basically Venezuelan American. I have been for a long time an activist in New York City in the Bolivarian Revolution. And I have been able to see for these 3 months everything what the government has been doing to support its own population in front of this pandemic. Before that, I want to mention that I stayed longer because my doctor, I have a physical condition, and usually when I travel, I speak to my doctor. And when I was getting back to United States, I spoke to my doctor, and basically he said to me, don't come back to United States now, stay there, because things are going to get very ugly here. And I was not understanding, so I said to him, what's going on? And he said to me, well, the pandemic that took place in China is coming here, and this government is not doing anything. So that was the first time, I'm talking about maybe more than close to 2 months, that I heard about it. So I decided to stay, thanks to my doctor. And basically, it was very interesting to see that in a few days after I spoke to my doctor, on March 17, President Maduro went to the national TV and basically mentioned that he was declaring the total quarantine for the entire country. The total quarantine, when the quarantine started, I was able to go to Yaracuy, that is a state next to Carabobo. But basically, a few days later, they prohibit, the government prohibit to travel from state to state. So now we cannot go to another state, but also we cannot go too far for our place, for the place where I live. Immediately after that, the government started to campaign to disinfect, for example, the public transportation, the subway, the buses, the theaters. They went with all kinds of equipment to disinfect all these public spaces. But not only that, they started to receive support from Venezuela, started to receive support from China, from Russia, and even from North Korea. not only equipment, but also doctors. Venezuela has a number of doctors from China working here. Also a big number of doctors from Cuba working over here. So this process of disinfection is taking place right now all over the country. In fact, yesterday, there was a national day of campaign against the coronavirus all over the country, and they organized teams all over the country to disinfect the public areas. This is something very important that a lot of people don't know in the United States. But the thing is that already Venezuela had tested more than 250,000 people. So already we have, according to the government, the government said yesterday that we have 197 people infected with coronavirus. And let me get the exact number. And basically, the majority of them are fine. Only 9 people have died. Only 9 people have died. This is a country that is completely isolated, a country that is under pressure by United States, that is have a bunch of sanctions imposed by United States and its ally in the region. When you see the United States allies in the region, you will see the most of them are in very bad shape. But okay, my time is getting there, but I want to say also that the war against Venezuela is not ending. It's only beginning. We have a warship in front of the Caribbean Sea, in front of the Venezuelan coast. We have also, just a few days ago, intentional fires all over the country. People from the right-wing people were trying to get irritate the airways of the people that were living close to those fires to see they can get sick. So all these kind of stuff are going on right now. There is no gasoline in the country. Venezuela is an oil exporter country, but because the economy sanctioned, the economy sabotage, we don't have gasoline for 1 month. But still, the government has been able to implement through the support that it's receiving from China, Cuba, Russia, and North Korea, a program to fight back the virus. Thank you very much.
Thanks, William. Our next speaker is Lee Soo Hin, who will be speaking about how China has managed the COVID pandemic. Lee Soo Hin is the director of China-US Solidarity Network, a longtime undocumented immigrant worker rights activist in the US, currently a medical worker focusing on developing cancer medical technology and in-depth COVID-19 research. He'll be talking about China's successful experience fighting the virus.
Thank you. Let me tell a little bit about myself. I've been a long time undocumented worker in the US, has been working on the really a day labor work for many years. And then we organized ourselves from Los Angeles for the immigrants worker rights. And then also May Day national actions. Sure. Then for many years, I've been because of my working on the community, then and for the workers, they have a very specific need, and they need a medical attention. So I'm not medical degree background, because I start from the need for the peoples on the community in Los Angeles that they need the medical works. So I start from there, then slowly from amateur, then I become a professional on this kind of work. Then since the late 2008-2009, because the increased tension between the U.S. against China, then I decided to going back to China, between U.S. and China, to work for binational activism, solidarity work, also on the medical work, to support the global south and using Chinese technology. So that's my simple background. So I in China, because I working in many, I've been a friend and then association with many medical workers, and from doctors to hospitals. I know that's how the system works in China. And also, I know many people has been directly involved in the fight against the COVID-19 in Wuhan, and include the doctors and medical workers and nurses. And I know American friends who teach in Wuhan. So I have many first-hand information. What you see on the U.S. mass media, especially, and I'm not even talking about the right-wing Fox news, but even in many left-wing progressive media has been sending a really bad message about the China effort on fight the virus. And this is not from China. This is a racist. Anyone said this is a China virus or Wuhan virus, that is a racist, because no one knows where it's coming from. And we're not putting any wild conspiracy theory. So this is not something like coming from some kind of wild, any kind of lab or that kind of thing, but that's no proof that it's coming from China. And this should be a virus that is a universal. Anywhere could be happen, anywhere anyone can be got infected, and everyone around the world should come together to fight against the virus. But in reality, instantly, many countries choose not to do the right thing. Instead, they have been blaming other countries or closing the border or slowly respond. What I have been seeing in China has been doing for the last couple of months has been remarkable. And that's the reason why the outbreaks started very fast in Wuhan on January, but able to stop in March. And 2 weeks ago, finally, China can lift most of the restrictions, and then life getting slowly normal. Why, how they did it? Number one is a national mobilization. And the country from the top to the bottom, to many sector of the communities, to the ordinary citizens, they united to agree to fight against the virus. From tens of thousands of volunteer medical staff, the 42,000 medical staff went to Wuhan throughout the lockdown to support the fight against the virus. Within 2 weeks, they built two makeshift hospitals that can house 2,000 patients each for very serious medical conditions. And then, not even mentioning another hundreds of thousands of non-medical volunteers have been involved in Wuhan. And then if we talk, that's just only city of Wuhan, 11 million people. It's bigger than New York City. In entire China, that could be tens of millions of people mobilized from medical workers to ordinary citizens to fight against the virus. That's the reason why that's been highly effective, highly successful for China can stop the virus in very short period of time, and the so-called flattening the curve. That's the problem. I saw many people saying that, wait a minute, based on my country, US or something, that we couldn't do it, then China cannot do it. So China's data is a false. It's a wrong conception. You should see the other way. Based on what China has done, then as a benchmark, other countries did not do what China had done. Social distancing, mask, and mobilization, enough medical supplies to fight against the virus. That's the reason the other countries, especially like the US, has been out of control and miserable failure, and they're causing the major humanitarian disaster in the US. And I know the time is coming up, so if you need, I can put my email and the website on the chat, and then people can contact me, because we do have email list and information. If people want to know more, I can happy to put you on my email list, and then we can talk about more offline. Thank you.
Thank you, Suhin. If you're interested in getting involved in struggles like these, We encourage you to join Workers' World Party. So you can go to workersworld-party.org/join to learn more. Next up, we have Brian Shea from the Boston branch and the Disability Justice Caucus of Workers' World Party. Brian, can you tell us about the impact of COVID-19 on people with disabilities?
Yes, I, comrades, thank you all for having, having this this very important forum in the first place, and also having me, just contribute. From my experience, I work in Boston as a mental health peer support specialist, and I've also been working in the independent living movement for years, and the party has for a long time been working around, in and around the sections of the disability rights movement. What is going on right now is there's two things. One is isolation. You have folks who a lot of disabled folks experience isolation before a global pandemic, because the infrastructural supports for people who live in the community are not there. Because it's not profitable for capitalism. We need to remember that the United States voted against ratifying the Convention of the Rights of People with Disabilities. Venezuela did. Cuba did, China did, and there are a lot of countries that are building socialist construction and moving towards a socialist organization or society. They have, ableism is embedded in capitalism. That's one thing that's going on. Another that is showing itself again in the context of this pandemic is there's a lot of eugenics stuff, quite flat out, that's coming out. You hear things like some of these capitalists and their political stooges, or there was this guy from some elected official from, I forget where the hell he was from, Missouri or someplace, he was saying that it's a lesser evil for susceptible people to die than it is to open up the so-called open up the economy, meaning make workers work to create profit for the bosses. That's why anybody on Twitter, you can see the hashtags, not dying for Wall Street, and disabled versus the Dow, but also, that stuff has always been there, and it shows itself Cuomo has cut the Medicaid budget. He's cut out the personal assistance program, the self-directed personal assistance program. But folks are organizing to try to break down that isolation. And it's become evident that to everyone in the world, in light of the pandemic, that the US is a failed state and capitalism is a failed system. So what we need to work everyday capitalism is creating more of its grave diggers, and we need to build socialism, build a workers' world. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Brian. And I just want to remind people that following the speakers, the speakers are going to answer questions that you have put into our Q&A box. So please make sure that you take a few minutes to do that. Next, I would like to introduce Dominic Harris, who is the president of the Charlotte City Workers Union chapter of UE Local 150. And Dominic has been a leader in organizing to build public workers' right to organize, as well as fighting racism and unfair treatment of public workers in this period. He will also be speaking on racism in the healthcare system. Dominic.
Hey, everybody. I guess I'll first begin on a note of the work that we've been doing to gather workers' power in the South. UE 150, as you know, what you might not know, began when the Communist Party came down to organize workers in Greensboro, and the KKK ended up teaming up with the police to invade that rally and kill 5 workers and injure 19 others. One of the leaders in our union, that's a retired worker from the Cummins diesel plant, Jim Wren, actually has a metal plate in his head from that event. But out of that, workers up in the North came down and formed Black Workers for Justice. And what they did was get jobs in the local municipalities and began starting to form unions. We later on in like the 90s or the 2000s linked up with UE and became UE 150, a chapter of UE 150, a local in the union, local in UE. So from that, a few years down the line, I started getting active in the union, and we began facing what we've seen, as I would describe as a long-term implications of racism, where once you have a system that is racist, no matter what faces you put in that system, continue those same racist practices. So I'll say, like, once you get people to see themselves as less, see themselves as just workers, somebody that's punching in, punching out, and just collecting a paycheck and doesn't really see any value in themselves or their worth as workers, you can basically start doing more and more to them to make them feel less and less. So as our current campaigns come up, and as we started fighting for higher wages and getting more rights for workers and even engaged in Medicare for All, we start seeing people look at themselves like, hey, I have health insurance. It's not the best, but it's all right. Why would I want Medicare for All? Why would I want a system that empowers me more? And a lot of them wouldn't even get to that question because they're still hung up on what they're given instead of what they can get. And that's a lot to do with racism, because when you have a master telling you what you are allowed to have and what you can have and what you don't deserve, then you slowly start getting beat down and don't even realize what you are able to have. So we started spreading the word about Medicare for All. We started spreading the word about getting higher wages. And we did that work and ran up to a couple of roadblocks. And these roadblocks that you have already been long established. I mean, long established before we even got into the fight. So you ask a man why he's working a job and then has to quit, stop that job, not quit, but stop that job and go and work at another job and be fine with it, perfectly okay with it. Why aren't you fighting for higher wages? The first thing they'll tell you is because I don't want to get fired. Kind of like going down to the South and telling slaves to come up north so you can be free, and they tell you, I don't want to go because the trip is too hard. Whenever you fight, it's going to be a hard trip. Whenever you fight, it's going to be more difficult than what you are going through now, but you're going to have better in the end. So when we start comparing these things to like the fight that we have today and the racism that of a racist system, we got to look at the leadership too, because most of the city council is black or brown. We have very diverse city council, but what they did was step into the seats of the white men that occupied them before, and instead of changing the system where it benefits everybody, they continue the same practices that those old racist members of city council maintain. So whenever workers do come to them, the few that do gather and realize their power, come to them and say, hey, we deserve more. They still look at them as the same way that those old racist white people did, because they're sitting in them seats now, and they say, no, you don't. They look at them and say, we understand you. We see where you're coming from, but you guys are on the ground workers. If we give you more, then we're going to miss out on our bottom line. We aren't going to raise taxes because we want to maintain power. We aren't going to do things that are going to benefit you guys because we may lose our ratings. We may not be as seen as a good destination for people to come to. Our city won't maintain the same status. So we're going to take advantage of you workers on the lower rung. We're going to benefit for your labor. But the moment that that becomes an inconvenience, we're going to get rid of that labor. I think the latest thing I see as a big smack in the face when you have a black man that's sitting on city council as the city manager, and he says that we aren't going to go into money that the employees made us $116 million that the employees were able to achieve through their labor, that we have set aside as a rainy day fund. We are going to use that to benefit them because we require them to come in during this time as a premium hazard pay. We aren't going to use that for that, because if we did, we may have to fire those same workers because we did use that to benefit them. So you see that same practice. You see these things coming through and echoing because it has a racist structure. And even if you give that racist structure a black face, the problem still persists.
Thank you so much, Dominic. So we want to hear your feedback. Once again, we have Q&A at the bottom of the screen. You can just type in. And also we have a poll that we're going to put up so that we can get your thoughts on some things. So that should come up. There it is. So if you are interested in getting involved in the struggle, we encourage you to join Workers World Party. So you can go to workersworld-party.org/join to learn more. And just hang on a second. We're going to pull up some questions. And our speakers are going to give 2-minute closing remarks and response to these questions.
So I think we're going to start off with a question for Sue Hin. And how did China compensate the workers who built the extra hospitals? Because in this country, it's a big deal. You know, there's a lot of people out of work and people are not getting paid. What steps were taken to provide for food and other basic needs for people on lockdown in Wuhan province?
That's a good question. Government community has been supporting each other during the lockdown. The medical work, just to be more specific, the workers who build the hospital, you saw that within 2 weeks, has been paid, has been compensated, and most important, also has been honored. Like, that's a tens of thousands of the workers has been, or medical workers has been involved in the fight against the virus, has been socially and nationally honored with a recognition. So that is very important. Not like in many other countries, not like in the US, that's never been recognized. Or I heard that the crazy story that one end, that's the US medical system, has lacking medical staff. On the other hand, they have been laying off many medical workers because they're losing money due to coronavirus. It's not happened in China. The workers in the people living in the Wuhan during the lockdown has an entire national and social support system doesn't exist in US. That means that there's a volunteers and has been organizing food drives. There has been and also the workers, medical workers coming from the outside town, they have a place to stay and well fed and stay in hotel. That has been well published and well documented. It's not just this is not like only few people got that kind of a special treatment, but everyone. So that's very important. That's the reason that's never been has a buying spree, the hiring like happened in the US that at the beginning of the March, and to that the people were crazily went to the supermarket, buy anything they can lay finger on, from toilet paper, that's crazy, to the food. It never happens in China because number one, well organized. Number two, people trust government and the system can support them. And number three, the most important thing, and China's anti-virus effort has been very successful, and the Chinese socialism has been very successful. Julie?
Thanks a lot, Suhin. That was actually really, that was really great. It's fantastic to be able to have that insight. The next question, and this is for any panelist who wants to jump in on this, but do we support nationalization of our healthcare industry? If you want to talk about how that might change. Yeah, I think we see Annika. Okay, go ahead.
Hi. So just to answer the question about do we support the nationalization of the healthcare industry, I would say yes. In the demands that were put out several weeks ago, the socialist demands, one of those was to nationalize healthcare under community control. And that is, from my point of view, now being in the healthcare system, training in the medical field for over 10 years, that is the only way that people are going to get competent healthcare. So that's just my view. Thank you.
I think what might be helpful would be if other panelists want to respond to the questions. I mean, I think we could all come online now so that we know who okay. wants to respond to these questions.
Sure. Absolutely.
Okay, Brian.
I would give that one also a hearty hell yes in terms of nationalizing the healthcare system. In terms of, closing down these parasitic insurance companies, mobilizing the resources that healthcare workers and workers in general have created, and and also making creating the systems that make them responsive to the community. You look at the model of the Cuban family doctor program. You look at this the Committees for the Defense of Revolution, you look at, there's just so much that we can do with a system that is not based commodified, and that with a system that is ours. Okay.
Anyone else want to jump in? And Shani?
Yeah, hi. I'll answer. Hey, Betsy. That's a comrade from Philly who asks, what other activities have Black and Brown Workers Cooperative been involved in, given Philadelphia's problems with gentrification and police brutality? Thank you for that question, Betsy. Currently, we also have an anti-displacement platform that we were already organizing before the pandemic hit, before COVID-19. And so we were doing a lot of land reclamation work, taking back parks, breaking chains on stuff that should be, not privately owned, but open to the community. These are things that we knew we had to organize around, because the same Black and Brown workers and marginalized workers who lack agency and decision-making power in their workspaces also lack that in our neighborhoods. We don't have that decision-making power in our hoods. So we had to really organize, and we did. We organized and got a former councilwoman, Janie Blackwell, out of her seat, who was basically making big bucks striking deals with developers off of long-term Black and Brown residents' backs, and that was like a really big win for the people, because she had been in that seat for like decades, and before her it was her husband. Like that's like an oligarchy. I don't know, like it was bananas, and so that's one way, is also targeting people in power who we know are key players in displacement in our neighborhoods. On top of that, now of course we joined in the national rent strikes, because all of us are like organizing double time. We have no way of really paying ourselves right now, those of us who are gig workers, so we've, in my building alone, we've declared a rent strike against our landlord, where the demand is complete rent forgiveness, so we want to be, obviously we're organizing with other comrades in Philadelphia around this. PTU is doing a lot of work around this. And I think the other piece of the question was about police brutality. I really do want to lift up Philly Real Justice around this, because they're a Black organizing group in Philly that has really done a lot of work around police brutality, and we've really worked in solidarity with them to really, like, for example, shut down highways and blocks where police precincts have been, and after a Black man was gunned down in Philly, and so like together we've just really put a lot of public pressure on some of the police precincts here in Philadelphia. But for real, that piece, I want to just hold up the comrades from Real Justice around that. So
We have a question for Dominic. North Carolina is home to a billion-dollar hog industry, including Smithfield Farms. Can you talk about the conditions that Black and Brown people live under, especially in the rural areas near these hog farms, and the pre-existing diseases that make the population susceptible to coronavirus? Oh, sorry, Dominic, you're muted. We don't hear you quite yet, no.
Something's happened to your sound, I think.
Yeah, because it looks like you're unmuted.
Should we move to another question until we can?
Yeah, I thought I saw Suhin raise his hand. Did you have something to say, Suhin?
You have to unmute.
Let me unmute. Yes, unmute now. So, yes, definitely. Nationalized healthcare system. I just want to add 2 cents. I've been in this country for 30 some years. Of course, I have sick before, but I never go to a hospital here because I cannot afford it. When I got sick, or maybe I want to do some medical need, I fly back to China to do that. It's true. Many people have the same experience because the cost of to go to see a doctor in China and the US is at least 90% cheaper. That's the reality. And that's the reason why the China can we can fight against the COVID-19, because not just the cost, but also because nationalized medical systems. And I was just the cost is, if everyone wants to say the cost, I just checked the news that average spending for Chinese health, the hospital in Wuhan to treat the COVID patient was per average per person was around they said roughly 25,000 RMB. So that means it's $4,000, around less than $4,000 to treat a patient, and then it has been paid by state, so no one need to pay. That's how, why more people willing to come, people come forward to go to see the doctor in China. That's how, why the disease not further spreading and can be contained, and people got treat faster and better. And not only talking about all this medical supplies and then all this kind of technology. That's an advantage for the national healthcare system.
That's a thank you very much. I see a question in the comments about rent strikes, which is an incredibly important issue.
It's I just wonder if Dominic is able to, if his sound is working, maybe he could, we could just go back to that question. Maybe not. Okay, I just thought maybe.
Can you hear me now?
Oh, there yes. You go. Okay, so yeah. Dominic, just before you go, I just wanted to say that next week we'll be talking about May Day and general strikes, and so that the issue of rent strikes is definitely going to be brought up on our next panel on Thursday at 7 p.m. Right here. So, but yeah, Dominic, if you could go ahead and answer that question, I'm glad to have you back.
Okay, so Naima Muhammad, she's the wife of a senior member of our union. He was actually international organizer, Muhammad, Saladin Muhammad. And she done great work on exploring the environmental injustice and racism in Eastern North Carolina. So what goes on over there with those hog farms is that these lagoons form from the mist that they spray up in the air, created by, it's like the feces and the dirt rolls off the pigs down into these lagoons, and what they do to clean them is mistify the airs, to the point where people that live in those communities have to peep their heads out of the doors in the morning to see if it's okay for them to go out and live their daily lives, to go out and get groceries or their medicines or whatever they need to just exist. Unfortunately, we see those conditions persist all throughout the United States of America. And what it does is cause health conditions like cancer. You see cancer clusters overwhelmingly in Black and Brown communities. You see asthma, all type of respiratory illnesses. You see all type of diseases that specifically, even you have hookworm and a third world disease in Louisiana. You see all these diseases pop up in these Black and Brown communities. And once these are brought to our political establishment's ear, they do nothing about them, because here in North Carolina, we had a trifecta for a while. We had a Democratic House, Senate, and governorship for a while, and they did nothing about them because the pig farms and these other industries that cause pollution in these areas have the money. They give them to whichever party is in control. They don't really care as long as they can get it, as long as they can get their ends at the end of the day and stay in power. So we see racism in the United States being pollution as well as political racism.
Thank you so much, Dominic. I want to ask our panelists, this is not directed to one person in particular. This was a question. Can I have some comments comparing the so-called defense or military budget and in reality the killing budget, which of course has bipartisan support for ever increasing racist wars, in contrast to the uphill struggle of workers and oppressed peoples for even basic medical care or a healing budget, and how this relates to capitalism, sort of comparing both the drive to war and then the struggle that we're really seeing unfold right now with COVID-19. If people would want to speak to that, maybe, I don't know, raise your hand and then we can just take you in that order. Okay, Dominic, I see Dominic's hand.
I'm going to speak specifically to Omar Gaddafi. That's what happened with that. That was during the Obama era. Again, a black man, like you say, put a black face on these politics, but as long as the establishment or the system is racist, it's going to keep up. But Omar Gaddafi ended up opening up a bank that was actually giving loans to other African nations, and that was his greatest sins. They said it was the nuclear bombs, but once he gave those up in the same nuclear deal that we essentially had with Iran, he gave up his nuclear weapons, and then they were like, okay, wait a couple of months. I don't think it was a full year before they said, okay, we're going to go ahead, come in and still bomb the hell out of you. It was simply because it was a black nation that was loaning to other black nations that was starting to become powerful in the world. The same as Venezuela was starting to become powerful in the world until they crippled them with sanctions. The same as all these other Latin American black and brown countries start to gain power. They come in saying, oh, you're terrorists, or oh, you're not doing what we say you should do. And they find some reason to go after these countries. And the only thing they do is get the media to manufacture consent by putting out these messages that make those countries look way worse than what they really are. When the truth be told, the number one sponsor of terrorism in the world is a strong case that it could be argued it is America.
Yes, thank you so much. Annika?
I just wanted to comment on that question as well. It sounds like it's asking to compare the budget, you know, of our military industrial complex to our healthcare system, and why those are in such contrast, and why they're so different. And it really comes down to, you know, living in a capitalist state, increasing the budget for the military industrial complex allows the capitalists to make more money, wield more power via imperialism. They are more invested in destroying and killing working class black and brown people abroad than they are in providing comprehensive health care to the working class black and brown people at home. And that's what it is.
Yes, thank you very much. So I'd like to ask William how Venezuela is making sure people get fed during this time, especially considering the horrible U.S. sanctions that are restricting aid into that country.
Yes, can you hear me? Yeah, huh?
Yes, we can. I'm sorry, couldn't hear me, but yes, we can hear you.
Okay. Basically, something that is very important is the doctors that are working with the communities. As I said before, it's a group of Venezuelan doctors, Cuban doctors, and a small group of doctors from China that are working with the communities all over the country. First, and the second step is that these people go to the community door by door, visiting everybody. And they provide some questions to determine who is sick, who really needs some support. And sometimes the support has not to be exactly medicine. Sometimes it could be food. Sometimes it could be something that people need, because we have right now in quarantine and people cannot move around. So they support this community. The government has already, as I said before, tested more than 200,000 people. And that's a big number of people for a country like Venezuela that is completely isolated or blockaded by the United States and his ally. As I said before, tons of medicine is coming from China, Russia, especially from China and Russia. And that has been very helpful. Also, core support from Cuba is coming too. And also, in the middle of this crisis, that is a global crisis, the United States has been imposing more sanctions to Venezuela, and also has been moving military arm in front of the Caribbean Sea, from the coast of Venezuela, and threatening the Venezuela in the middle of this crisis. As I said, we don't have despite everything, despite all the pressure, despite all the attack coming from the United States, the state has been able to provide food to the people that need it, to those people that are in need, and also to provide the medication, free medication, something that is completely, when you think in the United States, that is one of the biggest countries of the world, a superpower that is not able to provide free medicine to its own people is something completely incredible. Also, we have 5,000 people coming from Venezuela, immigrants that left the country just a few years ago, and now they decide to come back because what's happening in Ecuador, in Peru, in Colombia. So they have, some of them are coming walking to Venezuela. And they have been received at the border, and with a group of medical doctors that are waiting for them, they just make, the first thing that they do is a test. They as soon as they determine that they are no, they don't have the coronavirus, they basically take them to another place to be isolated for 20 days. And the other group, the people that get positive in the test, they get to a special place to get the treatment. Basically, people don't have to go here to the hospital to see that if they have coronavirus. They have just to make a call, and the doctor, they don't want people to go to the hospital because you can contaminate the hospital, no? So they want people to call them and to say, hey, this is my situation, that this is my this is the kind of stuff that I'm suffering right now, can you send someone? So they send a doctor that's going to provide a test and to determine if that person is sick. And then if the person is sick, it's taken out of the community to another place where we'll be isolated and we'll be receiving a treatment. But the most important thing is not to have people living in the community when they are sick, because you can spread the sickness is all over. So that's what the government has been doing, and have been until now very successful. As I said, with all this pressure coming outside, you know, coming from the United States.
Thank you very much. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I just had to add the lack of gasoline, the lack of, even because the blockade is a reality, there are a lack of a bunch of other stuff that made the life of Venezuelan people very hard.
Right. Thank you. Thank you very much. I know that one of the concerns of the panelists, it's been mentioned several times, has been the treatment of people behind bars, whether they be prisoners or jail detainees or people in some of the detention camps. Trump has made very famous a drug that he declares will cure the COVID-19, and that's hydroxychloroquine. And so the question is, and it was directed to either Shani or Annika, but anyone can answer. Have you heard that the Federal Department of Corrections has purchased a supply of this hydroxychloroquine, and it is not, since it is not an evidence-based effective treatment, do you worry that prisoners will be treated with this against their will?
So I'll just say quickly, so if I'm not mistaken, right, the chloroquine, Trump has money invested in that. Like, that's a drug that he's invested in, right? And so we have this like really oppressive president, like regime in place, who's also invested in like putting out these so-called cures that have already killed some people. And I absolutely am worried that they would issue this to prisoners against their will. Like, I mean, yes, absolutely. As a Black person living in America and in this world, I put nothing past the possibilities, you know, and the attempts on the lives of Black people, especially Black people living on the inside. I absolutely think we need to be paying attention to how this unfolds.
Thank you. So another question we got is about the car caravan protests. And there have been some protests by white supremacists asking to open the economy back up again. If anyone would like to respond to this, you know, in terms of who they think are organizing these and how this, you know, what this eugenicist strain in the right wing is all about. So if anyone wants to respond to that. I see Annika and Suhin. So let's just go to Annika and then Suhin.
I did want to respond to the hydroxychloroquine question because that, and just what Shani said, absolutely correct that, you know, Trump has very questionable investments with this medication, and that in and of itself is a huge red flag. I mean, huge red flag. Also, just speaking from a medical standpoint, this medication is, you know, it's not Tylenol, it's a big deal. It has serious side effects. Those side effects can be fatal. And when you're talking about doing a study, especially a medical study on prisoners, that's unethical. It's absolutely unethical because what you're doing is you're saying, I will offer you comprehensive medical care if you take this experimental medication. That's unethical. That's an imbalance of power. And they know what they're doing. They've done this before. They've done this many, many times. And what they're banking on is they're banking on the fact that they have done their best to make prisoners voiceless. They've done the best to make their friends and family voiceless. And they're banking on the lack of a spotlight on this situation. I've also seen a proposal to do this type of study in Detroit. That is also... On the part of these people, that's also very, you know, we know why they're doing that there. And it's completely, it's beyond unethical. So I just wanted to say that. Thank you.
Okay. Yes.
I know we saw Suhin.
Wait. Oh, okay. Oh, I'm sorry. Suhin. Yes.
Okay. I saw the report about that, that what happened in the protests, and then I want to open up the economy. It's a really right wing because I see people have been waving a pro-Trump signs and all these U.S. flags, and so that's definitely is the I cannot say it directly who will be organizing it, but that's from definitely from the. From the right-wing Republicans and pro-business, and they want to push it. It's very dangerous. It's everyone know that right now is not the time to open back the economy because that will be going to push the pandemic worse again in the U.S. And I want to make medical points of view. Two things. I just want to say this: people are saying that flattening the curve, but in a seriously medical research area, that's a nonsense. Because in U.S., even Cuomo said yesterday that now that see the peak, we're going to go in the back, we'll be going down the curve. But in reality, the pandemics, the situation in U.S. is not like a bell curve. It's like a plateau. That means that it seems like we're going down a little bit, but it's not going down a lot. It will be just keep staying the high level of the infections and death rate for a while. Why? I mean, again, going back to China's experience, that means there's not enough social distancing in U.S. There's not even enough testing in the U.S. There's not even enough treatment to help the people. And especially on the people of color and the immigrant community and African-American community, that is a totally disastrous. So that means that it's not going to see that saying that now we see the peak and then we're going to see the like crystal balls, peak and then we're going down. It's not. In U.S., we'll be very dire situation. We'll be going to stay in the peak for a while, maybe up and down a little bit, but that will be. It'll be devastated for a long time. So the people doing this is not just stupid, but also is a really, really racist because you can see most people are protesting, unless I'm wrong, a majority are white. And then why they want to do it? Because they want to keep the status quo, and then the big business want to make money, but not caring about the suffering workers, special people of color, and immigrants now still working on the factory, and then now picking the fruits and vegetables in the California farm field, the so-called the guest workers.
That's right. Thank you so much, Suhin. In fact, farm workers are still fighting for their own, for PPE, for, you know, for personal protection equipment, as well as other workers around the country. I'm going to ask a final question and direct it to all of you, but I was wondering maybe if Brian Shea has something to do with this. So with all this information, why do we need socialism? So Brian, if you unmute, we can hear you.
Okay, great. I wanted to go back to Cameron McCassie's question on this whole this kind of Malthusian shit that's coming out now. This is an old ideological tool of capitalism. That's been a tool of them since the 1883 Chinese Exclusion Act and the 1924 Immigration Restriction Act. It's been used against immigrants. It's been used against people of color. It's been used against people with disabilities. But overall, it's been used against workers. It's been used against working people, and it is part of the way it's showing itself now is that, you know, they're actually saying to people, you know, Grandpa, your staying alive is not as important as these workers put money in my stock portfolio. I'm excited about the plans for a general strike on May Day. This is going to be an axis of the class struggle right here. You know, the bosses are going to say, come back to work. And the workers are going to say, we're not going to risk our lives for your profit margin, and you don't show us anything that, no hazard pay, no safety, anything like that. We need socialism because, you know, in a socialist society, the workers can make these demands and say, this is what we need to do. And the workers can fire the managers when they don't go along with that. So that's my contribution. That's my 2.5 cents. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. Anyone else want to answer that? Why do we need socialism?
I'll chime in. I think the most important thing about socialism is that it gives power back to the people. It lets us realize that we're in control, like we essentially are in control now, but it's a government top-down, bottom-up perspective that shows everyone and tells everyone and has a system that is created for the workers, whereas we're in control of the means of production. A lot of people might say that socialism is the government running everything, but when you have socialism and the people actually in control and holding their government politicians to account, unlike how we do now, whereas a politician is only money that can hold them to account. Capitalism, if I'm a rich CEO and I don't like what you're doing, I'm just going to give my money to somebody else. Therefore, it's me already. It's elites holding each other in account. Socialism is the people banding together and say, no, you aren't doing or passing legislation that's in our favor. So now we're going to get you out of office and put somebody in office. Meanwhile, we're in control of this business. So no policy that you do pass can affect my paycheck. You know what I'm saying? So with social, why we need socialism is so we can keep up, even in a crisis, these essential services such as grocery stores, gas stations, water services, trash service. We can keep those going at a pace that is healthy for us and safe for us workers to go into without having to be told by a hierarchical elite power structure that has all of the power in this current system.
Thank you so much, Dominic. And we really need that now. We really, in terms of responding to this crisis and to this pandemic. So if you like what you have heard, we'd like you to go to workers.org/donate or to Venmo at Workers World and make a donation so that we can continue to grow our audience. Workers World Party is a revolutionary organization. It is not an agency, and we are totally volunteer. So we need your support. Makasi?
Absolutely. And if you're interested in joining a revolutionary socialist political party, and you want to join, go to workersworld-party.org/join. And you can just sign up right there and someone will get back to you as quickly as possible.
And then finally, our next webinar is next Thursday, April 23rd, on the call for a May 1st general strike. I know there was a question today. We didn't get to it. I'm really sorry. But we sort of are running out of time. And so it's about the May 1st general strike and building up working class resistance to COVID-19 capitalism. Please join us and check out workers.org for the link to register for that. And Makasi, you want to give the last announcement? You have to unmute.
Yeah. So April 24th is Mumia Abu-Jamal's 66th birthday. So we encourage all of you to check mobilizationformumia.com. That's mobilization, the number 4, and mumia.com. For updates on major events coming up next week, including a webinar on Friday, April 24th from 6 to 9 p.m. So please check that out. And have a good night, everyone. Build a workers' world.
Build a workers' world. Thank you all for joining us.
Thank you, everybody.
And thank you, panelists. You did a great job. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you.
Talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, comrade.